Hello friends, like CPM, today we will see another scheduling tool, that is PERT, in project management. So PERT is basically a program evaluation review technique. Using PERT, we will see how to get the critical path in the project, and also we will see how to find out probability of project completion in given period or said period. So let's see. Hello guys, today we will see the PERT. Using PERT, we will try to find out the critical path in the project, and along with the critical path we will see how to calculate the total possible time for project completion as well. Along with that, we will see how to find out the probability of project getting completed in the given period of so. Now let's have, this is a problem which is supposed to be solved by PERT. Now basically, what is the difference between PERT and CPM, that is critical path method, is that in CPM we have only one time estimate for each and every activity, while in PERT there are total three time estimates you can find out for each activity. Now in this chart we can see the activity is given, the preceding activities are given, and apart from that three time estimates have been given: optimistic time, modal time and pessimistic time. So in this three time estimates, we'll see how to get optimistic time and pessimistic time and modal time as well. The optimistic time is the time estimate for each activity in such a way that all uncertainties for that project are being ignored. And when these uncertainties or risk are being considered, that time we get whatever we get the time estimate, that time estimate is called pessimistic time. So this is all about optimistic time and pessimistic time by considering uncertainties in that project. Okay. So apart from these two, there is another time estimate that is called modal time, which is being considered after taking opinion from the experts who have worked on similar kind of projects earlier. So this way, for each and every activity, we have three time estimates: optimistic time, modal time and pessimistic time. So we'll come to the first example, first question, that calculate all the expected activity times and variances. So we'll see how to calculate these activity times and variances. So friends, basically depending on these three time estimates, we can find out some effective time period, which can be representative time activity for time period for each and every activity presented in the table. So the formula for calculating the effective time period is optimistic time plus 4 times modal time plus pessimistic time divided by 6. Means by taking the average of these six parameters, means one for optimistic, four for modal and one for pessimistic, we get this effective time period. Apart from that, this is what the variance, that is called the square of standard deviation, can be calculated by b minus a divided by 6 bracket square. It means pessimistic time minus optimistic time divided by 6 bracket square, you will get this square of standard deviation, that is called variances. So we'll calculate these time periods and variances for each and every activity present over here. Now in the first case, we have here for activity P, we have optimistic time 1, modal time 4 and pessimistic time is 7. So that effective time period and standard deviation or variances can be calculated in such a way that by using this formula as, so time period, effective time period for the first activity can be calculated as, A is what? The optimistic time, that is 1, plus 4 times modal time, means 4 times 14, 4 times 4, that is 16, plus optimistic time, pessimistic time, that is given 7, divided by 6. So we get here 4 into 4, 16 plus 1, 17 plus 7, that is 24. Divided by 6. 24 divided by 6 is 4. Similarly, we can find out the variances for that activity, first activity, that is b minus a bracket divided by 6 bracket square, that is 7 minus 1, 6 by 6 bracket square is 1. So we get 1 as what? The variance for first activity. So this way we can calculate here, we can write down, we can make another table, or two tables. I'm going to add one for effective time period and one for the standard deviation. So we're getting effective time period for first activity as 4 days, and the variance for the first activity as 1. This way we can calculate the effective time period and variance for all other remaining activities using the same formula, effective for effective period and variances. So this way we get effective time period and the variances for all these remaining time activities as given below. Okay. Now we will construct a network diagram, project network diagram. We'll start with the activities P and Q. As there are no preceding activities for P and Q, so P and Q are the activities which are going to start from the event 1, and we'll continue with the network diagram from 1 to 2 and 1 to 3 as activities P and Q. So friends, this way this network diagram has been constructed. I'm starting with the activity P. So activity P is given. It has no preceding activity P and Q. So both the activities P and Q are going to start from a single event. So from event 1, I'm going to start activity P and activity Q, which I'm meeting at node 2 and 3 respectively. Now when I'm coming to activity R, the activity R is having preceding activity as P. It means that once activity P will get finished, then only you can start with the R, right? So I'm just checking once whether R is preceding activity for any other activity. Yes, it is there. R is the preceding activity for T and U along with Q. So R and Q are going to meet at a single node. Is that fine? Wherever they will meet, then only from that point only you can start activity T and U. So R should get finished where Q is meeting, okay? So I'm coming to this point where Q is meeting at node 3. I'm supposed to draw activity R after finish of activity P. So this activity R should come at node 3 itself. It means that R is having preceding activity as P. At the same time, R and Q are meeting at the same node. R and Q are meeting at the same node, means T and U are going to start from the node 3 only. So once R is finished, I'm coming to point S, activity S. S is having activity P as preceding activity. So just check whether S is anywhere preceding activity is there. Yes, it is there along with T for activity V. So I'm going to draw activity S from node 2 where P is finished. Okay. At node 2, P has been completed. So I'm starting with activity S meeting to node at 4. Fine. So I have completed P, Q, R and S. Now I'm coming to the point T. T is what? T is the preceding activity for V along with S. Means wherever S is getting completed, that time T should finish at the same node. So I'm starting for T, okay, which is what, which is having preceding activities R and Q. So where R and Q are completing, from that activity, from that node, I'm going to start activity T. And that activity T should complete at the same node where S is being completed. So that is what activity node 4. So I reach to point node 4 where S and T both are coming at the same node over here. Now I'm starting with the activity U. If you see here, activity U is having preceding activity R and Q again. Means from node 3 only you are going to start activity U where R and Q are meeting. So I'm going to start this activity U. Activity U is not having any preceding activity. It is not acting as a preceding activity anywhere in the network diagram, U and V. So these are what the final activities, U and V. U is going to start once R and Q is finished, and V is going to start when S and T is going to finish. So from this S and T is being finished, I'm starting with the activity V. And from this node at 3, I'm going to start activity U. So both these final activities are going to be meet at final event that is called final event 5. So this way this network diagram has been completed. Now we'll see how to try the effective time period I can put over here in this network diagram. I know for P, the effective time period for P it is given 4. So 4 days I'm writing for P. Similarly for Q it is 2 days. For S, for R, it is 5 days. For S, 4 days. For T, 6 days. For U, 1 day. And for V, it is 6 day. This way I have written all the effective time period for these respective activities. Now we'll see the earliest start and latest completion time for each and every node given in the network diagram. So friends, once this network diagram is completed and we have written all this effective time period for those respective activities, now we are going to start with the earliest start and latest completion time for each and every activity over here. So I have created two boxes here on each node where I am going to write down earliest start and latest completion. So earliest start, we have formula ESJ is equal to maximum of ESI plus duration. J and I what finish and start node of that point, of that activity. Okay. So I am starting with the node 1. For node 1, it is as it is a start event, so I am going to put earliest start as 0 only. We know this calculating earliest start is what? The forward pass. So we are moving from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 like that in forward pass only, like from start to end. So I have written 0 as earliest start for the node 1. When I am moving to the node 2, there is a calculation period. That is what? The maximum value to be chosen between what? ESI plus duration. Okay, the ESI is what? Earliest start for earlier node plus duration, that is 0 plus 4, we are getting 4. As there is only one way to reach from to reach to point 2, that is the only way, so we are calculating this much calculation only. So when it is moving from 1 to 3, there are now for calculating early start for calculating for node 3, there are two ways. One is from 1 to 3, second is what? 2 to 3. So we'll try to calculate this earliest start, that is 0 plus 2, it should be here 2. But there is another way, that is what? 4 plus 5, that is 9. So maximum of these 2 and 9 is the maximum value is 9. So I'm writing here the maximum 9 values over here. Similarly, at node 4, there are two ways, 2 to 4 and 3 to 4. So one is 4 plus 4, 8, and second is 9 plus 6, 15. So maximum value is 15, so I am writing here 15, 1, 5. Similarly, way to reach node 5, there are two ways, 4 to 5, 1, and 3 to 5 is 1. So 15 plus 6, 21, and 9 plus 1 is 10. So among these two values, 21 is highest value, so I am writing here 21. So this way we can complete the earliest start for all the activities. Similarly, we can complete what the latest completion time to be considered in backward pass. So as it is a backward pass, I am writing the same figure at node 5 in latest completion time as 21 itself. And the latest completion time can be calculated by latest completion time can be calculated by LCI is equal to minimum of LCJ minus duration. So we'll check LCJ for node 5, it is 21 for activity. Now I'm going to consider activity V first. So for 5 to 4, there is only one activity is there, 5 to 4 in backward pass. So it is what I'm going to consider 21 minus 6, it is what? 21 minus 6, it is 15. So I'm writing here 15. So when I'm moving to U, so it is what? 5 to 3 and 4 to 3. These are what two backward paths are there for node 3. While calculating latest completion time for node 3, there are two backward passes are there, 5 to 3 and 4 to 3. So one is what? 21 minus 1, it is 20. And second is 15 minus 6, it is 9. So minimum value between 20 and 9, it is 9. So I'm writing here 9. Got it. The similar way when I'm reaching to node 2, there are again two ways in backward pass, 3 to 2 and 4 to 2. So in 3 to 2, we are having 9 minus 5, it is 4. And second is 15 minus 4, it is 11. So the 11 and 4, the minimum value is 4. I am writing here 4. Now I am moving to the node 1. Again there are two ways in backward pass. One is from 3 to 1 and second is from 2 to 1. In backward pass there are two ways, right? So one is what? 9 minus 2 it is 7 and second is what? 4 minus 4 it is 0. So I am getting 0 value here. That is the minimum value between 7 and 0, right? So this way I have completed the latest completion time and earliest start time for each and every activity or every node over there. Now we'll start, we'll find out the exact or critical path in this diagram, in this critical path method diagram. So we'll see how to get that critical path first. Now I'm starting with the activity 1. Okay, we have the conditions for that. That early start must be equal to early start of the second node, early start of early start of this node 1 must be equal to latest completion of node 1 should be equal to what? Latest completion of node 2. Early start of node 1 is equal to early start of node 2, like that. Similarly, 4 minus 4, 0 means latest completion minus duration is equal to latest completion of 1. Latest completion of 2 minus duration, it should be latest completion of node 1. So this way I am getting 0 and this is what? Now the next condition to identify the critical path in this network diagram. So to get critical path, we have to recognize the condition in such a way that early start must be equal to the latest completion time. At the same time, if we are considering two nodes together, which are connected by a single activity, that time we should consider that the latest completion time minus duration should be equal to latest completion time of the earlier node. Like 4 minus 4, it is 0. Similar case is for earliest start also. 4 minus 4, it is 0. So if I am considering activity P, that is from 1 to 2, this is 0 and this is 0, so node 1 it is there in critical path. Whether node 2 it is there, yes it is there. Early start is equal to what? Latest completion. And 4 minus 4, 0. 4 minus 4, it is 0. So this is what I am getting, one of the critical path. So activity 5, P would be a part of what? This critical path itself. Now moving to the next. From activity 2 to, I'll see 1 to 3, whether it is part of critical path or not. It is early start is equal to latest completion and early start is equal to latest completion. But when I'm considering latest completion minus duration, 9 minus 2, I'm getting 7, which is not what? The latest completion of node 1. So it is not a critical path. So next I'm moving to what? 2 to 3. Again 4, 4, 9, 9. Two values are equal. But 9 minus 5, 4. 9 minus 5, 4. So again, this is what critical path I am getting, 2 to 3. Okay. I am just checking 2 to 4 is whether it is a part of critical path or not. 4, 4, 15, 15. 15 minus 4, 11. So 11 is not there as latest completion time of node 2. So this is not a critical path. Now 1 to 2, 2 to 3 is the critical path. Now I am moving to what? 3 to 5. 3 to 5, 9, 9, 21, 21. But 21 minus 1, 20. 20 is not there. So this is not a critical path. I am moving to 3 to 4. 9, 9, 15, 15. 15 minus 6, 9. 15 minus 6, 9. So this is what a critical path. Similarly, we can check 15, 15, 21, 21 for activity V. And 21 minus 6 is 15. 21 minus 6 is 15. So again, this is what? Critical path. So we got critical path as the critical path as 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 5. So the total time period completion of project is nothing but 4 plus 5, 9. 9 plus 6, 15. 15 plus 6, 21. So 21 days is the what? The total time period required for project completion. So this is what the total time period completion required for project completion. So we have come to the answer here now. We have drawn the project network diagram. We find out the critical path and we got the project project completion time period as well. Now we are moving to the next, that is what find the probability of project getting completed in 24 days. So guys, to get the probability of project to be get completed in 24 days, we have data here. We got the critical path, that is total project completion time as 21 days. So we have here mu is equal to 21 days. Okay. We want to check the probability whether project will get completed in within the 24 days or not. So for that, we have to find out probability of x minus mu upon z upon sigma. This probability we are supposed to find out, where mu is what, 21 days, that is what total project completion time. X is given 24 days. Sigma we are supposed to find out from that table itself, that is what standard deviation. So in this case we can write down this example. The very first thing, we'll try to find out this critical path or that standard deviation, which can be calculated from that the table chart which we have formed. So in this case, in this table, we have found that the critical path is 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5. Like that, it means what? 1 to 2 means activity P, it is there. This is the critical path. 2 to 3 means 2 to 3, that is what, activity R. Then 3 to 4, that is activity T. And 4 to 5, that is activity V. So this way we have 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 5. That is activity P, R, T and V. These are what the critical paths. So we are checking with the same. So these are what the activities or the critical path we have followed. Now with reference to this, I'm just going to mark the standard deviation 1 for P, R for 1 for R. For T it is 0.44, for V it is 1. So we can calculate summation of sigma square is equal to 1 plus 1, 2, 3, 3.44, 4. So therefore standard deviation, that is what, square root of 3.444 can be calculated as sigma is equal to. So friends, the square root of 3.444 we get as 1.856 days as was standard deviation. Now we can put this value in getting probability over here. We have x is equal to 24, so probability of z or probability of x minus mu upon sigma can be calculated as probability of x is 24, mu is 21, divided by sigma is 1.856. So we'll try to find out this value over here. So we get probability of 24 minus 21 divided by 1.856. So by taking this 24 minus 21 divided by 1.856, we are getting 1.616. Now we want to find out the probability of this. So from the standard distribution chart for this figure, we'll try to find out how to get this 1.616. So guys, I got the value of Z as 1.616, of which probability is supposed to be find out. So I'm using this standard distribution chart, where I'm using this 1.616 value in two parts, 1.6 plus 0.016. Okay, so from the vertical column on extreme left hand side, I'm just finding out the value of 1.6, and I have marked that total row of 1.6 in red one. Similarly, from the top row, the second value, that is 0.016, is supposed to be find out. So where I'm getting two values, 0.01 and 0.02. So in between these two values, the value of 0.016 will lie, right? So I have marked these two columns together.
Now I got here two values which are intersecting with 1.6. One is 0.9463, second is 0.9473. If I take average of both, I get around 0.9470. So my answer for this probability is 0.9470.
So friends, we are getting the value for probability of 1.616 as 0.9470 from standard distribution chart. So 0.9470 is nothing but 94.70%. So this is what the probability of project to be get completed in 24 days. I'm writing here probability of project to get complete in 24 days as 94.70%.